Praise the Lord. You may please be seated. Something of great pleasure. Consider it a great privilege to have been invited again to deliver the Christmas message this morning. I bring you greetings from Lagos Province 27, Fountain of Life Sanctuary, Adeokadeni Jones in Ikeja in Lagos. I pray that the love that binds us together will never be broken in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want you to please help me thank Pastor and Mrs. Tolu Makinde for the wonderful reception, the wonderful care, the wonderful hospitality, you know, since we came. The Lord Himself will reward you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 2, that very, very popular passage in the Bible that talks about the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. But for purposes of time, I will start to read from just from verses 6 to 9. Luke 2, 6 to 9, as we discuss the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them. The glory of the Lord will begin to shine round about somebody here as from today onward, in Jesus' name. The glory of the Lord is a discussion that you can discuss for a whole year and you still not finish. But as we know by now, we should know by now, the glory of the Lord represents the tangible presence. It represents the tangible presence of the Lord in a particular place, over a particular person, or over a group of people. Tangible presence. The Almighty God is everywhere. He's everywhere. He's present everywhere. But sometimes, He manifests His substantial presence. He manifests His tangible presence in a particular place, over a particular person, over a particular group of persons. Now, He could manifest that presence in the form of light. I just give God the glory when my sister was leading the prayers before the praise and worship. I said, Holy Spirit, I give you praise. Because that's a confirmation of this message to your children. You know, she was praying and talking about light and light in darkness, light in darkness. It was like as if she had read my notes. He could manifest that presence in the form of light. Very, very bright light. Beautiful, shining light. It is that light that is called the glory. I pray for you, from today onwards, you will begin to carry more than ever before the glory of the Lord in Jesus' name. It is that glory that is called, it is that light that we call the glory. The Bible says, our God has immortality dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto. 1 Timothy 6, verse 16. He dwells in the light which no man can approach unto. When you want to describe glory, you describe it as a very, very shining, bright light. If you look at Acts chapter 9, the Bible says Saul, who later became Paul, as he journeyed, came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. That light was so bright, that light that shone on Saul was so bright that the light even made him to go blind. That light is the glory of God. The glory of God represents the tangible presence. He can increase the intensity of his presence. He can make his presence very substantial. Even though he's everywhere, but in a particular place, he can make it so. You may not be able to see with your physical eyes, but you can be able to feel it. You can be able to be convinced that you have been in the glory of God. It represents the tangible presence of the Lord. This was why Moses told the Lord in Exodus 33, verse 15. Exodus 33, verse 15. He says, if your presence go not with me, carry us up not there. Which means he was saying, if your glory will not go with us, carry us up not there. I pray for you once again. Everywhere you go from today onwards, a greater glory will go with you in Jesus' name. Now, depending on what you know to do, depending on who you are, if you are a true child of God, as you enter that presence of the Lord, as you enter into that atmosphere of bright light, and you stay there, a part of that glory, a part of that light, as it were, can rub off on you. For example, in Exodus 34:28-29, after Moses had been in the presence of the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights, the Bible says the skin of his face shone so brightly that he had to put a veil on his face. The glory of the Lord had rubbed off on him. In the name that is above every other name, from today onwards, the glory of God will begin to rub off on you. Rise up on your feet. Rise up on your feet and pray. And say, Father, from now onwards, cover me with your glory. Cover me with your glory. Cover me with your glory like a blanket. Envelope me with your glory from now onwards like a blanket. Let your light begin to shine in my life. Let your light begin to shine in my life. You said I should arise and shine, for my light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon me. Father, let my light come. Let your glory begin to shine upon me. Father, let your glory rise upon me. Let your glory begin to rub off on me. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Just before you sit down, just one more prayer. Isaiah 4, 5, and 6. Isaiah 4, 5, and 6. He says, the Lord can make his glory to be a tabernacle. A tabernacle that will shield you from all the storms of life. You say, Father, let your glory, let it be a place of refuge for me. Let it be a refuge for my children. Let it be a place of refuge for my family. Let it be a secure shelter for me. Let your glory be a place of protection. Let your glory tabernacle over my home. Let your glory tabernacle over my marriage. Let your glory tabernacle over my business. Let it be a place of protection from danger, from distress. Let it be a shade of protection in this time of storms. Let it be my hiding place. Let it be my hiding place. Keep me secure, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. The Lord will answer those prayers in Jesus' name. Please, you may be seated. When we talk about glory, we are talking about splendor. We are talking about something that exposes you. When you carry the glory of God, when the glory of God rubs off on you, it causes you to be celebrated. It causes you to shine. In our text, the glory of the Lord shone over the shepherds, keeping watch over their flock. I want you to know something. That glory shone by night. Every form of darkness. Are you listening to me? Every form of darkness in your life that may want to disturb the glory of God from shining, the Lord will destroy it today in Jesus' name. The Bible also tells us that Stephen, you know his story, he looked steadfastly towards heaven. He saw the glory of God. The Bible says when he saw the glory of God, all the stones they were throwing at him had no effect. He could not feel the pain of the stones anymore because he was enveloped in that glory. No attack from the enemy will ever touch you again. I say, as you carry the glory of God, as the glory of God rubs up on you, no attack, no stone from the enemy will ever touch you again in Jesus' name. When the children of Israel were leaving Egypt, you know the story. The Bible says there was the pillar in the day, the pillar of cloud in the day, and there was the fiery pillar of fire by night. And these two things guided them. Like I said, you may not see with your eyes. I pray that one of these days God will open your spiritual eyes. And that pillar of cloud, everywhere you go from today, it will be guiding you. I said the pillar of cloud of glory will be guiding you. The pillar of fire by night will be guiding you. In the name of Jesus Christ. Now, what are the three things? Our time will only allow us to discuss three things specifically. What are three things that could happen to somebody on whom the glory of God rubs off on? Three specific things. We will look at those ones and then conclude by one major thing we must begin to do from today onward so that the glory of God will never depart from us. The first thing that could happen to anyone on whom the glory of God shines, like those shepherds in the field, the first thing that could happen to anyone of whom the glory of God rubs upon
is that spectacular miracles, fantastic miracles, miracles that can frighten,
will suddenly begin in the life of that person. And I will prove it to you. You know, one of the last things I did before leaving home, the end of November, was to promote one of our pastors that I was sure was carrying the glory of God. I knew he was carrying the glory of God. So God said we should promote him as his own now pastor. When I got here, I began to get messages from him.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. God has given this pastor who we recently promoted a bouncing baby girl after 23 years.
After how many years? You needed to see the naming ceremony. It was like a crusade.
When you carry the glory of God,
are you listening to me?
Spectacular miracles will begin, suddenly begin in your life. Let me tell you, there are miracles and there are miracles. There are some miracles that you will be so afraid to even share with anybody.
I remember the testimony of one of us in our church. We had prayed and prayed over his business. Suddenly, the bricks broke.
And he was talking about millions. Millions this way, millions that. I said, my brother, I wish you can just hear this testimony in the congregation.
He said, ah, pastor.
He said, the church is a mixed bag. The church consists of might be some armed robbers, might be thieves, those who will not allow you to rest, lazy, you know. That, no.
He said, please help me to hear it. Don't mention my name.
There are some miracles you will be afraid to share. And I discovered that even in the Bible, it happened. If you read Matthew 17, 1 to 9, just write it down. We don't have the time. Matthew 17, 1 to 9. The Bible says Jesus took three of his disciples to the mountaintop. You remember the story now. The Bible says the glory of the Lord rubbed off on them. A cloud of glory came over them. Jesus was transfigured before them. Jesus' face shone with the light like the sun. His raiment was white as the light. The disciples saw his glory. But the point is that as they came down from the mountain, you know what happened? Jesus charged them saying, don't you ever share this testimony with anybody. Don't you ever share.
Go and read that passage very well.
Jesus said, don't share it with anybody. There are some miracles that will begin to happen to you. You will not even bother to share because they won't believe it anyway.
They won't believe it. There was also the testimony of another two men of God, a senior one and a junior one.
Junior one began to tell the man of God everything God had been doing in his ministry. God gave us this. We expanded here. We did this. We did that. The junior one went on and on. Suddenly the junior one said, oh, daddy, I'm the only one that has been talking. You have not even told me what God.
The elderly one said, if I begin to tell you what God is doing for me and my own ministry, you will say God is partial. You will say God. They said, that's why I've just decided to keep my mouth shut.
In the name that is above every other name, the miracles that men will say, are you the only one that is serving God? The miracles that we say God is partial to you, those miracles will come to you in Jesus' name.
I say you will be enjoying those miracles now in Jesus' name. And you know what? When you carry the glory of God, it's not only you. The glory will extend to your children. It will extend to your household. You know the story, 1 Chronicles 26:48. 1 Chronicles 26:48. They brought the Ark of the Covenant into the house of Obed-Edom. You remember? The Bible says when that glory of the Lord began to reside, because the Ark represents the presence of God. It represents the glory. The Bible says when the Ark began to reside in the house of Obed-Edom, it says the sons, the children of Obed-Edom, became mighty men of valor. Mighty men of valor. Obedient children. Children that have become honorable, dependable. From today onwards, God will hold your children in high esteem in Jesus' name. People will hold your children in high esteem in Jesus' name. They will be outstanding. They will be greater than you. They will be pace setters for their generation in the mighty name of Jesus. So the first thing that you will certainly discover when you begin to carry the glory, when the little bit of the glory begins to shine or rub off on you, is that spectacular miracle. The second thing that will happen to you when the glory of God begins to shine is that you and your business will suddenly come out of a state of obscurity. You will suddenly come out of a state of obscurity. You will come into the limelight of success. That is another thing glory does. Matthew 5:14. He says, we are a city that is set on a hill which cannot be hid. No longer will anybody hide your business. I say your business will no longer be hidden. The glory of God will shine upon you. Men will see, they will see your good works. They will glorify your Father which is in heaven. They cannot see your good works if you are in obscurity. It's not possible. You are going to come out into the limelight in the mighty name of Jesus. You know, many of us have talents. Many of us have gifts. Many of us have potentials, abilities that are still hidden. They are still hidden. But in the name of Jesus Christ, you will not die until the whole world has heard about you. If you receive that, say amen. I say you will not die until the whole world has heard about you. If you look at the example of Joseph, Joseph had the gift, he had the talent of being able to interpret dreams. That was one of his gifts, that was one of his talents. But for a long time, this gift was hidden. You know where it was hidden? It was hidden in the prison. In fact, if you remember that story, he used that gift to interpret the dream of the king's cup bearer and the king's baker. You remember the story? In the prison, nobody heard about him because he was hidden. But the time came when the king of the whole land now had a dream. Nobody could interpret it. You know the rest of the story. That gift that was hidden came into the limelight. It was Joseph they had to bring out from the prison to come and interpret. Openly, I pray for you again. In the name of Jesus Christ, the glory of the Lord will begin to rub upon you, and all the talents that you are embedded in you that are hidden, they will come out into limelight in Jesus' name. If you look at the example of David, David had so many talents, so many gifts.
But at a time, for a long time, those gifts were hidden. You know where? They were in the bush. He had the gift of being able to play musical instruments. But he was playing the musical instruments only for the sheep in the bush.
Ah, but a time came when that gift came into the limelight. The Spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul. You remember the story? An evil spirit started troubling Saul. So, they recommended David. Ah, they will recommend you in Jesus' name. I said they will recommend you to high places in Jesus' name. Suddenly they recommended David. They said, we know somebody who is skilled in the playing of harp. If you can go and bring him from the bush and he plays it, the king will be well. And that was what happened. You know, I had some stories about our church because we have to be really, really very practical. I had a church in England and I don't think they're alive. I understand it got to a time because I suddenly saw the Archbishop of Canterbury in our Holy Ghost service. Because my father was the Bishop of Lagos, so I know what that means. The same Anglican church. The Archbishop, then I began to hear that there was a time they wanted to choose even the Archbishop. They went to our headquarters in London to be asking, who do you think? What is your opinion? There was a time they built a public building. They wanted a pastor to pastor that chapel in that public building. They came to request from our church in England for a pastor who can pastor it. There was a time there was a bomb explosion, and they said, we have seen the hundreds of thousands that attend your services. How do you think we can do this thing to avoid destruction if there is this and that? The New Christian Church of God. There was a time when Pastor Deboye told us, he said he went to the birthday anniversary of a king in Ogun State. And all the bishops, all the archbishops, you know, they were all in their regalia, everybody in the vestry and everything. And then he came in with his, his French suit. He said, one bishop came. He said, what are you doing here? He said, I'm the pastor of the Redeemed Christian Church. Redeemed Christian Church of what? Now that church, that same church, is the one the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Prime Minister in England, they are going to their services. I pray for you in the name that is above every other name. You will come out of obscurity in Jesus' name. I say you will come out of obscurity in Jesus' name. Finally, the first thing that can happen to you when the glory of God begins to rub off on you is that you will begin to enjoy vigorous health and vitality. Vigorous health and vitality. You see, because of the radiance, because of the shining beauty inside God's glory, there is nowhere for sickness to hide. Germs cannot stay. Sicknesses cannot stay there. Viruses cannot stay in your body. It cannot stay in the body of somebody carrying just a little bit of God's glory. Deuteronomy 34 verse 7. Deuteronomy 34 verse 7. It says, Moses, at the age of 120 years, was still as vigorous as ever. Do you know why? For 40 days and 40 nights, he was in the presence of God. The glory of God had rubbed off on him. So, even at the age of 120, the Bible says he was so strong, his eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. I pray that God will replace every weakness in your life, every sickness in your life, with his glory in Jesus' name.
In conclusion, one of the chief functions of the enemy, one of his chief functions, is to ensure that the glory of God does not shine upon us. He makes sure that the glory of God does not shine, because he knows the ramifications, if only a little bit can rub off. He knows that you will become a terror to his kingdom immediately you carry the glory of God. So, the person whose glory would shine must be ready to fight darkness. The person whose glory will shine must be ready to do battle with the enemy. And please, the darkness we are talking about is not the absence of electrical light. No. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about principalities and powers, spiritual wickednesses in heavenly places. Brethren, the darkness in this world is becoming thicker and more palpable by the day. It is time for us, children of God, to arise and shine. How? One of the things you have to do, you must be able to fight darkness. You must be able to get them to a standstill. I want you to remember Isaiah 60, which we all know. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, for the glory of the Lord has come upon you. What is the reason why he said, if you look at verse 2 there, he said, because darkness has covered the whole earth. Go and read it, Isaiah chapter 60, verse 2. He said, because darkness has covered the whole earth. You want to be able to shine? Oh, there are so many things I know you know. You know you must live in sin. You must not live in sin. You must live holy. You must be able to praise God. By the way, I want to give your hands to the choir for that beautiful short praise worship. You must be able to praise the. You must be able to know how to praise God. I'm sure you know there are so many things. But one major thing, you must be able to. Because darkness has risen over everybody. In a few minutes before I close, I want us to pray against some devices, some strategies that the enemy uses to cover our glory. In fact, when I was preparing this message, God gave me 12 different types. But time will not allow us. We just took about 3 of them and then we close. Number one, the enemy, through causing you to sin, the enemy, through your own carelessness, sometimes it's not even the enemy, it is your own carelessness, your own general lackadaisical attitude, he can make that glory to be truncated. What do I mean by glory to be truncated? He can make that glory to be cut short. If you remember the story of Eli and his family, the Lord told Eli, he said, your glory, Eli, is that it is only from your family that priests will be coming from. Was the honorable thing at that time, and I pray it is still now, for you to be a priest of the Lord. He said it will only be from your family. But what did the enemy do? Through sin, caused the children of Eli to begin to sin. They were sleeping with the ushers in the temple. They didn't have any regard for God's sacrifice. They were missing up, and Eli could not control them. God said, I was the one that said that it is from your family. And you see, when you get home, we don't have time.
When you get home, if you read that story very well, God said, it is from your family forever. Forever. That will be producing priests. But he said, now, that will not happen again. The enemy succeeded in truncating that glory. He cut it short. It was to be forever. But what did he do? He cut it short. Let me give you another example. Another strategy. There's a difference between truncating, cutting it short, and aborting it. There are some people, when the enemy sees that they cannot cut it short, he will even abort. So that the glory will not even rise at all. It will not even show at all. Not to talk of it, it was going at one time, now cut it short. There was the story of Abel and Cain. You remember? Abel was doing well. He knew how to worship God. He offered the best of his things to God. God accepted his offering. But Cain was not doing well. What did Cain do? He killed Abel. Even from birth. He never allowed us to know what Abel would have been if he ever lived. He never allowed us to see the glory of Abel. Brethren, let us be very, very, very careful. As much as we would want to be able to carry the glory of God, as much as we would want the glory of God to rub off on us, the enemy does not want it. And the enemy will never get you in the mighty name of Jesus. Finally, the third one. The enemy will always want to bury somebody's glory. Want to bury it. And you know, when the glory of somebody has been buried, the person will gradually begin to go from grace to grass. That will never be your portion. That person will be a focus point for arrows of shame. There will be all-round defeat on that person. The person might have been occupying a place of honor. All of a sudden, they will remove that person. You will be going downward and downward and downward. Why? Because his glory has been buried. You remember the story of Joseph and his brothers. There was a time, of course, because Joseph was a young person, he was naive, God showed him the glory ahead, and he was so naive, he revealed his secret to the brothers. The brothers said, hey, the sin of jealousy came in. There was a time that he was seeing him coming. They said, here comes the dreamer. They dug a pit and threw him there. And you know, they said something. He said, now that we will throw him in the pit, let us see what will now become of his dreams. They wanted to bury his glory. In the name that is above every other name, the glory of God that is going to begin to rub off on you today will last forever. That glory will never be destroyed. That glory will never be replaced. That glory will never be buried. I pray for you, you will continually shine. In the name that is above every other name, you will continually shine. It shall be well with you. In the morning, it shall be well with you. In the afternoon, it shall be well with you. When Jesus got to the house of Jairus, he drove out all those who were weeping. You know the story. In the mighty name of Jesus. Those who are thinking they will come to your house to weep with you this coming year, they will not succeed. Jesus will drive them out. I said, Jesus will drive them out. Everything that had died in your bodies, in your life, will resurrect in the name of Jesus. Anywhere you are sleeping spiritually, at the moment, God will wake you up. I say, God will wake you up. Whatever Christmas present that you are deserving or you are requesting from the Lord will grant it unto you. You will go from one level of glory unto the other. In the mighty name of Jesus. I discovered that God guards more jealously everyone that he has given his glory to. That was why Moses, they nearly messed around with Moses. The kind of punishment he gave Korah, Dathan, and Abiram was unusual. He asked that the ground open his mouth, and he drowned the enemies of Moses. Every enemy of your spirit, the Almighty God will drown them. In the name of Jesus, from now you will have a glorious new beginning. I say you will have a glorious new beginning. And everything you put your hands to do, it will begin to be glorious. In the name of Jesus. I want us to write. Just one more thing. I want us to close our eyes. Sin robs people of the glory of God. If you are still indulging in sin, there is no way the glory of God can rub off on you and shine on you. Because like we said, the glory of God is the presence of God. When you carry the glory of God, it means God is with you. That was one of the prayers that our sister prayed at the beginning of this service. But if you are in sin, there is no way God can walk with you. He said, can two walk together except they be agreed? Maybe you are here this afternoon. You are still living in sin. I want all eyes closed, please. This is another opportunity to say, Father, I want your glory. I know what your glory can do in my life. I know the spectacular miracles that can begin in my life. I know the great successes that can begin, but Father, please.